What's up, guys? Another week of Into a Podcast, War and War the Destroyer, with big, sexy Billy Swanson bringing it to you. Got a pretty cool guest today, Dwayne Loudermilk. He's the main event on my very first show, Elevate Fight League, January 14th in Canton. Get them tickets. Guy's a unique fighter, kind of a unique martial artist. He's exciting to watch. You know, I'll let him tell us about himself, but really excited to have him.
No, and I'm excited for us to start getting some of these interviews out there again and, you know, being able to kind of give these guys a voice. You know, like I said on last week's episode, you know, we both kind of got busy and might get busy in the future, but, you know, going to try and continue to at least get one out there a week. Ideally, yeah, I'm excited to have Dwayne on, you know, from the videos and stuff he sent me. He looks pretty damn tough. I might be wrong. Does he already have a belt?
I don't know if he had already won one. I know he's won some IKF, stuff like that, the tournament, stuff like that. I don't know if he's won one from, like, a regional promotion or not.
Gotcha. Yeah, I'd seen I think I saw a little bit on his Instagram where he had, you know, I think it was one of the NFC belts. And
he may have.
Which I know, I mean, if you win those IKF tournaments, depending on which ones you win, that those are world titles. So
Yeah, right. So, I mean, some of those, depending on which one it is and who shows up, you may have some tough fights and can be a well-earned belt, you know. And then there, obviously, you can't control who shows up or which, you know, sometimes it can be a little easier path. Like, I won my WK belt. There was five guys in the bracket. I beat the shit out of a guy pretty quick. The other guy forfeited. One guy left, and then I got the belt off one fight.
I mean, Warren, I'm not going to lie. If I was at an amateur kickboxing tournament and I watched you whip the fuck out of somebody, and then I was like, I got to fight that guy, you know?
Exactly what happened. Yeah, he was going home.
like that guy probably, you know, drank like a six-pack in the parking lot. He was like, fuck yeah, boys. I'm going to light some people up. Saw you whip the fuck out of somebody. He was like, all right, let's go back and get another 12-pack.
The guy I beat, the thing is that was funny about it, he got finished pretty fast, and they never should let somebody that – it's a referee stoppage TKO. He's back at the night show, and we're doing – we had fight, you know, a couple times that day to get the belt. And we're back at the night show, been my second fight for it, and the other guy forfeits, didn't show up. So they ask him again, they're like, hey, we've offered it to the other people. They wouldn't take it. Would you willing to rematch him for it? You'd be for the title. He's like, no, of course not. But how would they offer somebody that's been finished? That's so dangerous.
Well, no, that's the only thing that I'll say that, in my opinion, is very dangerous when you look at, like, kickboxing or boxing tournaments or even in that aspect, you know, wrestling tournaments, because you get headbutted a lot in wrestling.
Yeah.
And, you know, just the constant banging of your brain against the inside of your skull is not good for you. And and especially if you're getting fucked up.
I get it. If it's a decision, it was just a close fight, yeah, let him put his hat back in the ring. But it was a fast finish, like within a minute and a half. Like, there's no way that they should
all like, you know, and I guess that's the way it goes at those tournaments too. Like, you know, somebody could get knocked the fuck out cold and still technically be allowed to fight. Now, they've gotten a little bit better with it over the years because they do have, like, some medical staff on. And so I would say, you know, they would potentially pull you from the tournament if you're KO'd unconscious. Right. But at the same time, I feel like if I raised enough hell, you know, that would fight at that tournament if I got knocked the fuck out.
It was the weirdest thing. I was like, man, I can't believe they're offering that guy that. But, you know, it was just nuts.
But anyway, tell us about your event you got coming up, Warren. January 14th in Canton.
Yeah, big event for me, the first one. I mean, you know all about it. I've been kind of talking to you about every day about it, the odds and ends, and there's a lot of moving parts, but it's very gratifying to – it's getting closer. We're a month out. I got a few major things to do still, stuff's lining up. Got the doctor, got the EMT service. I think I got two major things, finishing the ring fab and getting it ready, or the backup plan is obviously renting the cage, and it's just – it's very exciting, but it's very stressful at the same time. But I'm excited to bring these fights to Canton because they've never been there, and everybody in the whole town is, that's all they're talking about. And so it's just a fun time. I'm happy to have Madsen down, and looks like as of today, we can't quite announce who versus who, but you know, until it's confirmed, but Chris looks like Chris is going to be on. So that's huge for me to have two of your best guys on. It's just going to be big.
No, and I definitely, man, it's very beneficial for the area. So like a lot of people, you know, they look at fighting like it's barbaric and it doesn't do good, but in my opinion, if you kill off all the alpha males like they want to do, then it literally, it makes a world full of weak men. And and when you have weak men and weak mentalities, then it's very easy for you to be controlled and be overran by a tyrant.
And just for example, what you're talking about not getting rid of the fighting, look how it's been for people, for instance, like Madsen, totally has changed his life. Gave him purpose, discipline. He's an upstanding citizen, you know, and nobody can say anything different. You know what I mean? And fighting has helped be a part, a cornerstone of that.
Well, and even at that, you know, like I can contest to myself. I was having this conversation with one of my athletes that was in here in the morning. And, you know, I was talking to him. I was like, man, you know, honestly, a lot of people don't tell you the dirty side of life, you know, like, and like, I'm honest, like I've contemplated suicide multiple times in my life. And just always found a reason not to. And there's not enough people that don't find a reason not to. And, you know, and I think that when you have something that gives you purpose and allows you to, fighting's not for everyone, but at the same time, neither is painting. Neither is math. Neither is half the shit in the world, you know, just like.
Let live. If people are enjoying it, it's not bothering you. Mind your own damn business.
Well, Thomas Jefferson has a quote. It says, this is either Thomas Jefferson or it's somebody famous, but everybody's a genius. But if you judge a goldfish on its ability to climb a tree, or live its whole life believing it's stupid, meaning that everybody has a purpose in life. But if you put them to a standard based off of someone else, they're not going to be able to achieve that. Right. And like, you know, everybody's got to kind of find their purpose in themselves. And I definitely think that, in my opinion, it makes, if you look at most of the CEOs and wealthy people in life, they come from one of two backgrounds, and it's either military or martial arts. And it's because both of which teach you how to have discipline and deal with adversity and have humility. And now, don't get me wrong, there are some people out there that fight and, you know, do martial arts that are kind of the screw loose characters. But for the majority of the people that train martial arts, it actually gives them more confidence. It teaches them how to manage their weight so that they're not sitting here taking all these bullshit supplement and bullshit diet plans and all that that's never going to help them. Then they're just wasting money on. They instead learn how to lose and manipulate their weight themselves. And then also they have that confidence in the technique, because what I tell everybody is, don't get me wrong, we all want to be that Conor McGregor and be millionaires and have all these fucking accolades. But the real reason why we all train martial arts is so that if some crackhead comes running up to you and goes to fucking attack you and your life's on the line, that you don't second guess the confidence that you have in said techniques that you have trained.
Yeah, you beat his ass, you take his crack.
Yeah, beating the crack out the crackhead, you know, like, and that's the thing, is like, people don't realize that, is like, you know, everybody thinks that everybody, the whole reason they train and become a fighter is really because, oh, they want to be this big bad motherfucker that everyone's scared of. No, in reality, we just want to have confidence that if somebody were to put their hands on us or our family, that we don't second guess the technique that we know, and we can fucking dismantle them and protect our family.
100%. A lot of people always be like, oh man, like, I get it, like, they think that every fighter's like a pit bull. No, I'm like more like a sheepdog, you know what I mean? Like, I'll put somebody in check, but that's not my intention. I'm just doing my thing, you know. I'd rather not have to put you in check. Just mind your business and leave me alone, you know.
Yeah, but like, and I think also that goes back to the weak men compared to strong men kind of thing, is like, weak men will have boundaries, but they'll allow people to continue to walk over. Strong men, the reason they're deemed alpha male is because they have a stake in the sand, and they're like, hey, if you cross this fucking stake, you're gonna pay the price. And they hold that word, whether that's good or bad for them. And you know, like, and that's the reality, is like, people don't realize that, is like, we need more people in the world that are adamant and stand to their word as to, you know, the wishy-washy bullshit. Like, I say I'm going to do this, but I do a complete opposite thing.
Right. 80.
But that's another talk for another time. So let's get Dwayne in here and let's see what he's got. Be sure to call Clark Salon and Spa today. They have a wide variety of services, including haircuts, hair highlights, perms, extensions, tinning, makeup, facials, lash lift, waxing, nails, massage, as well as they have flotation therapy. If you don't know anything about flotation therapy, it is one of the leading ways to recover your body. So like I said, guys, be sure to call Clark Salon and Spa. They have a very excellent staff and will always treat you right.
All right, guys, joining us today, Mr. Dwayne Loudermilk, the main event of Elevate Fight League One, is in the house with us today. 170-pound championship fight. I'm super excited to have him in here. Actually, one of the most dynamic fighters in the state. I'm excited to have him on the card. What's up, man?
Hey, how's it going? Thanks for having me.
Enjoy having you, man. And I know you train with Coach Johnny and a good friend of mine. I've known him for a long time. A highly regarded coach. This fight is a trilogy fight. You've won one pretty quickly. Lara won one. And this is to bury the hatchet, I guess. The rubber match.
Yeah. This is the one to end it all. You know, the first time I had a phenomenal performance.
Really was.
And the second time, my head wasn't in the right space. And I let that one get away from me. And now it's this is where we put this to bed. And, you know, after this, we can train together, be buddy, buddy, all that. But right now, that's my number one goal. Like, with this also being an inaugural event, with it being a championship fight as well, like this feels more like a bragging rights belt than like a full on championship. But even then, afterwards, I still would be open to defending and doing that thing for a bit before I turn pro.
And this was a major thing to me too. Like, you're right. Being a new show, I'm like, hey, if I'm going to have a belt or two, I'd like to at least set up the guys that maybe could defend a time or two that are really good in the region, that I could help you guys grow, and you're helping me grow at the same time. It could be good for all involved. And
you know, not to interrupt, but okay. So Dwayne, what's your record right now?
Currently, I am 2-3.
2-3, and Larry's had 5 fights, right?
Yeah, MMA. So Larry's 3-2. I think 3-2.
So even at that, you know, it's a rubber match between the two of you. And then, like, you're both quality athletes that have several fights. So, you know, like, that's where, you know, a lot of people try and put too much stock into their regional championship. And, right. And in my opinion, like, as an amateur, you're supposed to gain that exposure. Yes, you want to collect some belts along the way, but the real goal is to gain your following and gain your experience.
Yep.
And then also kind of bounce around and fight at a couple different promotions so you can see the good and the bad of the business and see, like, which promotions actually are treating you well and which aren't. That's one thing that – see, I had 10 amateur fights and then – three or four professional fights for the same promotion. And that was one of the things that I kind of didn't like, was the fact of anytime someone would offer me a fight somewhere else, that promoter would start putting down those other promotions. Oh, they fucking suck. You shouldn't go fight for them. If you go fight for them, then I'm not going to give you fights back here where you're local to. And so it really made it very hard coming up, until I was to a point where I built my name to where it was like, okay, I don't need you. I can go find these fights myself.
And I think that fight does. It's like he said, a bragging rights thing. There's more to this title than just there's been a lot fuming and going into these two. They're not, I mean, it's no bad blood, but it's just competitive blood. This is going to be a good fight.
Very competitive.
Yes.
And I have all the respect in the world for them. I can't take that win away, but I can also take another win home with me.
Right. And he does too. Likewise, both you guys talk the same. It's like both you guys are just true competitors. And that's why, to me, I was like, this fight needs to be a co-main or main event because of just the variables around it. There's more than just records at play with this fight. You know?
Right. Yeah. There's a lot of background. I didn't mean to make a storyline out of it, but the whole reason why the second fight happened in the first place was because I had a string of opponents pull out of fights for various reasons, whether it was injury or at the height, like last year, I was supposed to fight in January, but then my opponent got COVID 3 days before the weigh-ins. So it was, there's a bunch of factors that went into it, and I was just not active. So I was like, you know what? I understand he wants his rematch. Let me give it to him. And my head just wasn't in the right spot at the same time. So
hungry from losing. I can see it. You know, you're like, yeah, you're in a no man's land, and he's very hungry for a win. That's why the third fight needed to happen. I'm excited to make it happen. Go ahead, Billy.
I got a quick question on it. Okay. So because y'all, both of y'all have been there, you know, Warren obviously coaches Larry, and, you know, you fought him twice. So in the first winning, you said you won kind of, you know,
very decisively. He won very decisively.
Was it by decision, or was it?
It was a decision.
But he knocked him down once, I believe. Was that right?
And then how did Larry win?
It was once in the second round and once in the third round. Yeah.
Then how'd the second fight go? Did Larry win by decision in that one?
He won by decision. If I remember the scores correctly from the first fight, I want to think two judges gave me 30-26 and another one gave me 30-25. And in our second meeting, I think he got a 30-27 and a couple 29-28s. I could have that wrong, though. I know it was a much closer fight in the second one, though.
I agree. I think I wasn't at the second fight, but the second fight, Larai used a lot more better pressure, distance control, some tie sweeps and stuff.
Right.
Now, you'll see when Dwayne fights to negate the spacing. He's very athletic and very fast. If you give him space, he's one of the most dynamic guys you're going to see on a regional scene. So it was just a chess match, strategy match.
My question, that gives me a little bit better insight to ask this question. So with that being said, okay, the first fight you won kind of very decisively. You were able to drop Larry. The second fight, you know, it went kind of Larry's way. He was able to sweep you a little bit more and manage that distance a little bit better. So in this third fight, what adjustments do you feel like you've made without giving up your game plan or anything? What adjustments do you feel like you've made that have you come
up in this fight? As far as my training goes, I am preparing for anything. I'm treating it almost as if it's like a street fight because it's going to be a tough fight. I know he's going to bring the forward pressure. He's going to try and do more of those takedowns and take me down any way he can. So it's just getting ready for that, any type of training that involves, whether it's the boxing, the kickboxing, the clinch, whether that means standing and doing knees or going for takedowns, you know, it's preparing for everything. It's just a total refresh and reset on my training camp.
I like it, man. So brings us to basically we came in this backwards a little bit because we're so excited about the matchup and hyping the fight. Right. But like you market yourself well, you're a smart guy. Why fight? What got you into fighting, brother?
So initially, it all goes back to my cousins. Actually, my cousins were training in American Kenpo. It was a karate school that was a block away from where they lived and across the street from where my mom works. So with my mom taking care of them, a lot of times I would go with them over to the karate school. And a lot of times, you know, I would just sit off to the side and watch them do their thing. And like all kids' classes, they ended with dodgeball. And the instructor was like, hey, do you want to play? And me being a 7-year-old boy, I'm like, hell yeah, I want to play some dodgeball. And then 9 years later, that turned into me getting my first degree black belt. Started taking classes, started to help teach classes. And while I do still teach and love coaching people, I wanted to be able to test myself and see if all the skills that I've been working on for the last 20 years is applicable. And I call it active field testing.
Before we talked about that. Yes.
I like exactly what you said because I completely agree with it. I tell everybody that comes in my gym, I don't think everybody's meant to be a competitor and really pursue it at a world level. But I believe that everybody should step out there and compete at least one time because they have to deal with all that anxiety and pressure.
Right, is learning how to cope to a fight. With the nerves of everything.
Yeah, well, like, if you think you're nervous leading up to a competitive fight, imagine how you're going to feel when you know if you make one mistake, you're going to be dead.
Yeah.
Right. So like, the streets, so the whole self-defense situation.
That's what, right before we brought you in, that's what I was saying with Warren, is like, the whole reason we really train martial arts is essentially to make sure that if somebody ran up on us in the street and tried to attack us or our family, that we have enough confidence in our training and our technique that we can defend our family and make sure that all of us leave with our lives.
Exactly.
First thing I'm asking, if they're a wrestler. If they're a wrestler, I'm pulling my gun.
For real.
No, don't lie, Warren. Don't lie. I saw you pull out some sneaky triangles here and there.
Here and there.
See, that's my thing too, because like, everyone thinks I'm a striker, but I know some stuff on the ground too. Like, I have some decent takedown defense, I feel, and even if I do get taken down, I know a thing or two of how to attack from my back, or at the very least get off of it. Right?
Looking for superior hydration while also getting incredible taste? Be sure to check out Chaw Water. They have incredibly charged alkaline water that helps with so many different benefits to your body. So, like I said, definitely check out Chaw Water.
In MMA, if you're not a high-level wrestler, they win in the scrambles, and you're not going to catch up to that starting at a later age. But right. You can learn to wrestle off the cage or wall wrestle, and that takes a lot of the scrambling away, and it slows the game down some. And then you can hold your own a little bit. In MMA, that's exactly what I had to do. Learn to wall wrestle.
I agree to an instance in that, with saying some wrestlers are kind of advanced in fighting in a way. And it's because they're training a closer rule set to actual MMA than some of these other sports.
Yeah.
Where, on the contrary, though, if you look at like Russian Sambo, or even like jiu-jitsu, in a way, those can prepare you more for a fight in some instances than wrestling, because they allow submissions and
because of the rule set.
Doesn't.
Where are all the guys like Khabib and whatnot coming from? What are they? This combo?
Russian Sambo.
Yeah, and those guys are taking over.
Russian Sambo is pretty much a MMA fight.
Yeah.
They do striking, they do jiu-jitsu, and they do wrestling and like submissions. It's straight up fucking MMA. Mm-hmm. And they're training that from their kid age, from little kids all the way to the time they're adults. So that's why they're already ahead of other people in that game by the time they're in their late 20s to early 30s. It's right. Because they're training this for 25 fucking years. Yeah. Okay. They've not had to change the rule set.
It's the same thing with the Muay Thai fighters, like all the kids growing up in Thailand. They've been doing Thai and having fights every other weekend since they were 7 years old. So by the time they're 25, they have, you know, a record of 300 fights.
Exactly. You look That's at why like, States, Dwayne, if you're just going to do striking, stay. Talk to Eric Haycraft. Stay amateur, brother, because when you go pro, the fights are few and far between. Get as many.
Especially on this side of the world.
Yes, because I was against, I took the hard road in glory. I'm over here fighting these guys with 50, 60, 70 fights with 5, 6 kickboxing fights. It's tough. It was a steep learning curve for a minute, you know? So definitely, if you can, because the pay is not even that much in Muay Thai and in kickboxing.
Right. It's probably the lowest profitable combat sport out there. That's how you know I'm not doing it for the money. That's how you know I love this game.
That's nothing, and that's what the top tier of like a Muay Thai fight is in the U.S. You know,
well, that's what I was saying though about the wrestling thing is I don't necessarily say that you can't catch up to their level of knowledge because you can learn their level of knowledge. But what you gain from wrestling at an early age is that mental fortitude and already knowing how to do weight manipulation.
Right.
So you already know how to cut drastic weight, and you had to suffer when you were a child.
Used to it.
The experience.
Warrior when you're 20, 30 years old.
Because I was playing video games when I was a child.
Yeah. And so look at like, that was, I've watched a reel the other day on Instagram, and it was this monk, and he was talking about, you know, the reason you train martial arts is to forge yourself into a weapon. And everybody thinks that, you know, that can be done easily. Well, like, if you look at like Spartans and shit, they would send their kids off when they were like 5 years old to start training military. And that's what they do. they were forging them into a weapon so that by the time they were 19, 20 years old, nobody around was able to fucking touch them.
I got to get my son tougher. He's six and he's like on his mom's tit all the time. So how old are you, Dwayne? How old are you now?
I'm 27. I'll be 28 in March.
Still pretty young. All right. And what's your why, man? Why are you doing this? I know you said you wanted to test yourself, but now you've done that a few times. You're thinking about going pro with it. I mean, what's your purpose with it?
So, yeah, it's definitely to turn pro and get my name out there. You know, I have a lot of people that I've trained with over the years that I've seen do it successfully, and I feel like I could make some of the same type of success happen for myself. Mm-hmm. And it's sad just because of his most recent passing, but I always think about the Green Ranger, you know, Jason David Frank. Mm-hmm. He was one of the biggest inspirations as far as martial arts go for me. And I always said, you know, when I get done with the fighting career and Saban is looking for a new Power Ranger, like, call me, I'm right there. You know,
well, you got to build for it, man. This dude's jacked. Wait, do you see him at weigh-ins, Billy? He's, you know, 8-pack. Yeah.
It's funny because it's like,
Do you train with Walter?
No, I don't. He used to be with X3 and he was at a different location than the one that I usually at, because I'm in the North Marietta location.
Gotcha. Okay.
He's over there with Byron Bloodworth and Johnny Dunn and those guys.
Yeah. See, because I know I've seen you in photos before. I'm just trying to, like,
remember. You might also be confusing me and Walter just because of all the hair.
No, I told him about the hair.
There was somebody that Walter used to always take photos with that was shredded like that, like you and Walter both are. Yeah. And he also had curly hair. And I was thinking that it might have been you, but I guess not.
Yeah, probably another guy.
Yeah, another jack dude.
Another jack dude with curly hair.
Billy's trying to say, what are you trying to say, Billy, all black guys look alike or something?
No.
Just the one with the good hair.
Yeah. These guys got herbal essence hair, man.
Hey, man, this is all natural, too. Well, no stylings or nothing.
Give credit to Walter, too, because his hair is curly as shit and long.
He does. Oh, his is magnificent. That's like hair goals. Right, sorry. There.
And his hair get in my face. I'm like, man, your hair smells so good. What'd you put in it?
No, that's awesome. Okay, so ideally, where do you see yourself fighting in, you know, five to 10 years? Do you see yourself potentially you know, trying to go pro in it, or do you see yourself coaching?
Definitely, at least within the next, I feel in the next 2 or 3 years, I should be at the professional level, at least fighting for some regional titles, maybe national titles here and there too. I know MMA is the more profitable sport, so eventually we'll make that transition, but I love striking so much. I'm not in a rush to go to MMA. You know, I don't mind doing the kickboxing Muay Thai thing for a while and get a couple of titles there, just get the recognition. So that way, when I do transition to MMA, you know, I already have that fan base and they already know what I'm about. Kind of like that whole Stylebender thing where he did kickboxing for the longest. And as soon as he came over to MMA, same thing with his guy that he had his trilogy with, that same thing with Peloton, right? Had the huge kickboxing record, transition over to MMA was almost an overnight success given the work. So that's what I'm looking to do within the next few years.
Nice. So outside the cage, and Billy always asks this, but you know, a lot of times it'd be like, what's a crazy story involving a fight weekend or anything like that of any outside the cage drama you've had? It doesn't have to be a fight weekend. Could be, you know, a fight you had in high school. What's a cool story you got of any fights?
So I want to think it was actually the first time maybe not a cool story, but it was cool for me. Aside from the next day, it was my first time going to an actual MMA event, which was NFC at the district. And it was, I think, January of 2019. No, it was January 2020, because it was right before COVID hit. Mm-hmm. And it was my first time going to an MMA event. I'm like, this is amazing. I need to be here, but not up here watching. I need to be in there. Which is funny because that's where I ended up coming back and having my two victories, which is at the district. Such a cool venue. But I just remember watching all of the fights and being super inspired by it and just absolutely getting hammered. Just I got so drunk. And I woke up the next day, and the day after that, I got the news that Kobe, the whole thing with him in the helicopter, that he had passed.
Yeah.
So I, in my dumb, still drunk head, I'm like, oh no, I got so drunk that he crashed his helicopter. Like, I felt personally responsible as someone from LA. I was just like, oh no,
hammered.
I was that far gone, but I had such a fun time at that venue. And it was really like, okay, I need to put my foot down and I need to fight in that cage at this venue. And I made it happen twice.
The night that the huge brawl happened at the district, where those members, like 10 people fighting in the crowd.
Who was the main event of that one?
It was Travell. I want to say Travell Miller.
Was it Travell and TJ?
Maybe it was, but there's this heavy.
I wasn't there for that one, but I did see someone who was like on live when it happened. I saw it happen live, and it was, you know, shaky camera and all that.
Yeah,
but
security guard got knocked out, tons of shit, man. It was going crazy.
It was ridiculous. Yeah. I'm like, look, I'm probably one of the least dramatic types of fighters out there. I'm always like, I'm about respect. I'm going to do maybe like a video game or anime pose on the weigh-ins. And then, you know, I'll shake your hand and hug you after the fight, no matter what happens. Right. So any type of brawls or anything going on outside of that, you know, it's not coming from me or my side.
I don't do that shit. You know, and if my guys did do it, they'd hear about it.
It'd be a tremendous issue. So I'm as respectful as it comes. I'm trying to be the NMF of the Southeast.
And you know? All kinds of kinds. And I know with Connor and like Billy will talk shit about anybody, but he's in good natured with it. It's entertainment. So it takes all kinds of kinds to make it entertaining. I totally get that. If everybody was like you are, a lot of people maybe wouldn't watch, but when it's a good mixture, everybody can pick their flavor, you know?
Hey guys, if you're having any heating and air problems, be sure to call Chattanooga's most dependable heating and cooling experts, Bell Heating and Air Conditioning. Bell Heating and Air Conditioning is a full-service heating and air contractor serving the Chattanooga and surrounding areas with a home-based location of Soddy Daisy. They provide their clients with a comprehensive approach to contracting and specializing in installations and service for various makes and models of furnaces, central air conditionings, heat pumps, thermostats, humidifiers, electric air cleaners, air purifiers, and other HVAC products. So be sure to call Chattanooga's most dependable heating and cooling experts, Bell Heating and Air, for any of your heating or AC problems.
I just like people to know that when I'm to fight you, I'm showing up to fight you.
Right.
And that's in my opinion, okay, I've had the fights where I've been nice and, you know, both of us been humble and shook hands and been friendly before the fight. And then, like, in the fight, subliminally in the back of my head, I'm still trying to be nice because I'm like, oh, this guy was nice to me.
Yeah, the same thing happened to me my last two fights too.
With you. Yeah, I've done it before. What fans want to see is they want to see the fucking dog eat. They don't want to see fucking me come out hands being nice to you.
It's hard to mentally find this place where you can do both, and some people can, some people can't. You know?
Yeah, so I like to talk shit just because personally, in my opinion, it makes me and my opponent both know, like, hey, I'll be your friend afterwards, but when the cage door is locked, I'm coming for your head.
Yeah, and that's exactly how I feel going into this one too. It's like, look, man, it's all love except for those 2 minutes at a time where you're standing right in front of me, because as long as you're standing in front of me, you need to sit down in front of me. So that's just how it's going to have to be. And I can't be too nice or respectful at the time. Like, there's a difference between respecting someone's power and respecting their skill versus actually, like, you know, submitting to it. Right.
Yeah.
You, especially in a fight, you don't have time for that. So like it or not, I'm coming for him. I'm like, I know I put him down a couple times last time, but I'm looking for him to stay down longer than 10 seconds, than 15 seconds. Like, sit down for a little bit. I'll help you up when the ref calls it off. But so, till then, I'm coming at you.
Yes, that's exactly why I make a fight like this with respected people, because I know these guys, you know, have nothing but respect for Dwayne and Johnny. They're going to come to fight, man, and Ryze too, and that's just in the best of ways. After that fight, everybody's going home to their family, but winner, you know?
I have one last question for you, okay? So you've experienced – you've had five fights now, okay? This will be your sixth. So you've experienced a little bit of, you know, both sides, you know, the good and the bad of the sport. So to anybody that's, you know, looking to potentially get started in the sport, you know, is already had a fight or two, or, you know, on their way up, what is any advice that you, maybe some things that you would advise for them to look out for, and then also some good things that you advise to help them further their career?
So the biggest thing for me, as far as someone who's looking to start fighting or continue fighting, even if all of their plans hasn't gone the way it has, trust the process, because I've learned more from my losses than I did from my wins. I still learn from my wins, but there's not as much as you can learn as, okay, not only what did I do wrong, but what did they do right? And how can I emulate that next time I'm in front of somebody? Or how can I prevent them doing this thing to me? Don't be uncoachable. Like, listen to your coaches, especially when it comes to doing something new, because that's probably the thing that you needed that you didn't have before. And you didn't even think about it because you thought you had all the answers before. So I always think about the guys who have like three first round knockouts on their record. And they're just like, yeah, I can do anything. It's like, yeah, until you run into someone with more experience, run into someone with more power, right? You got to take those experiences and use that to mold you as a martial artist, but also as a fighter in general, like whether that means inside the ring or not. Like, I mean, use those experiences to really evolve as a person. Yeah, exactly.
And same thing, he fought Tyson Fury, and Wilder's a champion, don't get me wrong, but just a small example, nobody ever took his power. When somebody could take his power, he was like, oh man, what has happened?
Right. It's like, what happens when your number one Sunday best weapon doesn't work? Where's your plan B? Well, you need B through Z.
Yeah.
You gotta account for everything. And that's like what we're doing.
Game, man. I like that about you. You gotta be coachable. That's the best attribute you could have. Very good answer.
Yeah, because what are you if not a collection of your coaches, right? Mm-hmm. Because every coach teaches everything different. Even the way Johnny teaches is a different way from how I teach. But it's so similar that, you know, most people can grasp it. When they're training between the two of us. But even still, there are things that I can show people and there are things that Johnny can show people that the other one couldn't. Yep. So you become an amalgamation of your coaches and then whatever style and flair you bring into it. Yep. Like me, I know everyone's looking at me like, oh, he's a mini Raymond Daniels or MVP or Wonder Boy. Like, he's another karate guy. Like, yeah, I bring that stuff in because that's my background. I'm not going to abandon it if it works for me. But I know that I can also add to it too, like the clinch game from Muay Thai, boxing for my hands. It's becoming a little bit of everything, being well-rounded enough to where you can stand in front of anybody.
And that's what amateur career is about. And you've taken tough fights, you know, out of those five fights, every fight was a tough fight. And that, I think that's key to growing.
Right. Like my first fight, my debut fight was at 55. That was my first experience with a crazy weight cut. And as far as kickboxing goes, like with Lyra, I could do the 170. Like, yeah. I know we're both naturally 170s, but the last guy that I fought at 173, that was technically light heavyweight for K1. So he was actually like 190, 200 by the time he got in the ring.
Right.
So, you know, weight classes exist for a reason.
Yeah.
So not looking past this guy at all, because he's my 100% focus right now. But after this one, I might end up doing a Southeast K1, either at 167 or even 159. We have to see how this one goes first.
I think that
go from there.
155 is a little small for you, but a lightweight cut where you can still be healthy and lose a few pounds. You're right.
Right.
You're still large for the weight class without dehydrating your brain, you know?
Exactly. Yeah. That's the fine line there. Cause I know I can hit 165 and still feel great. Right?
Yeah.
But there's not a lot of 165 divisions out there.
Right.
So, you know, the next one down would be 55. And usually I get a 2 pound allowance. So really it's only 57. So like, you know, I can do the weight cut math there and be okay. But I like fighting at 170 because I don't have to dehydrate myself completely.
Right,
you I can still feel fresh in the brain.
Performance, right, right. Well, anybody give a shout out to,
yeah,
man?
Yeah. Last thing, anyone you want to give shout outs to? Sponsors, you know, coaches, family, and anybody.
Still looking for the whole sponsors thing, but if you guys like all the merch that I've been having throughout these last fights, I got to shout out my brother Anthony Morris. He is my number one artist. He's my brother. He's my designer. He does everything. He's the one that came up with the Master Milk nickname in the first place. So I got to give him props there. We are also making a Master Milk video game, so be on the lookout for that eventually. But yeah, shout out to Johnny Dunn, my trainer up at X3 Sports, everybody at X3 Sports, North Marietta, all the guys that I train with. They also helped me train for my fight. So I'm learning right along with them. So I really couldn't do it without my teammates. But other than that, anyone else who's a big supporter for me, everybody who watches this interview or even just listens to it, whether you want to see me get punched in the face or want to watch me punch someone in the face, you're still going to watch me. So I appreciate you.
Man, well, we thank you for coming on and talking about Elevate Fight League a little bit. And, you know,
thanks again for having me.
It's just amazing.
I really appreciate it because first time I'm having my name on the main event, first time having a title fight, and we get to finish the trilogy. So I'm real happy about how everything is shaped up. 2023 is going to be the year.
A lot of stuff went into that decision. You know, we got some other good fights on the card, but I was like, man, hype to it. This one has to be the main event, you know? Plus, it's a striking fight. I don't want to see that grappling shit as the main event.
Right. So, quick question. I saw TJ Holt. He's co-main, right? That's an MMA match?
Correct. MMA. Okay. And there may be one more. Like basically a co-main would be Billy's guy, Chris. We're confirming that today at 185 for the third title.
Nice. Okay. Three title fights. Wow.
Mm-hmm. So,
that one's a hell of an MMA fight.
That one is a beast of a fight. Probably for the records wise and just the ability to be big league very fast. That right. one is a definite banger of a fight.
Because there's what, like 18 fights on the card?
Yeah. 18 fights. Yeah.
That's amazing. So. Yeah, just being able to watch all those while I can before I start warming up and getting ready.
And I'm going to fast, and no intermissions or maybe one 10-minute. We're going to try to get in there and roll with it. I know fighters hate waiting. I want to be done by 10 p.m. is the goal. So
like, I'm the main event. I want to go first.
You're right.
Everybody's already watching.
Same way, yeah. And we're trying to get in there and get it rolling and not look back. So that's one thing I learned at Billy's cards. As a fighter first and then a promoter next, it's like, man, I don't, you may have to take an intermission here or there to figure out what the hell is going on, but his shows right. run fast compared to a lot of shows I've been at.
Yeah. I don't like to sit around. I try and by the time the show starts, no matter how many fights I have on the card, I try and have us out of there by 4 to 4.5 hours.
Yeah.
Like, okay. I think I've got you in there more than that, then fucking it's miserable. I've been at cards where, you know, I've not fought till like midnight or like fucking almost like 1 a.m.
You're right. There for hours.
Yeah. And dude, it's like, why in the fuck am I here this long?
Like the second fight that I had with Lara, it was the co-main. So, you know, the fight started at 2 and it was outside. So it was already like sweltering Georgia heat. But it wasn't until like almost 4 or 5 o'clock that we actually got in there. So, yep.
Crazy.
As a fighter turned promoter, I appreciate you guys.
I'm sure there'll be some stuff to get better at, but we're working at it.
Having problems with fatigue, anxiety, stress, inflammation? Well, then be sure to call The Farm Tennessee LLC. They're a locally owned CBD and hemp farm that specializes in CBD and Delta 8 products for recovery and any other needs that you may have. So be sure to call The Farm Tennessee.
Well, and that's our overall goal, man. It's like we've been there and we've had to suffer through the bad shit as well. And so we're just trying to kind of get better outlets for you guys, not having to deal with all the bullshit that we kind of had to deal with. Like, that's really how I put on good shows myself, was I went to a lot of these different shows, whether I was coaching at them, competing in them, or even just going to spectate. And I would see all these different things that these shows would do for the good for the fighters. And then I would also see what they would do for the bad. And I've just tried to nullify all the bad and implement all the good. And so, right. You know, and that's one of the things that it used to annoy me was just the overall them just dragging it the fuck out because they're trying to make the customers that showed up go buy more from concession stands.
Right.
I think that's horseshit. Like, I think everybody, you know, if you're in there more than 5 hours, you should have, if you're in there more than 5 hours, you better have well over 20 fights on the card.
Like, yeah, exactly. At that point, like, it's basically a jiu-jitsu tournament.
Yes.
All day affair.
Terrible. Yeah. Like, and you should kind of tell people that, like, you know,
yeah.
If you're going to have like 25 fights or some shit, like, start the card at like 2-3 in the afternoon.
My so goal is to book 18 and 15 will work out. That's usually what happens, you know?
Right. Because there's always something that falls off.
Yeah.
I already saw that we had to find a replacement for a fight.
That's our fourth replacement for DJ.
Y'all are just beginning to see.
Yeah. So I'll props to you.
Look, I had people literally just not show up to weigh-ins on my third event.
Terrible.
They sent in walkout music. I booked them a hotel, all sorts of shit. And then just no-showed me the day of the event. They had been replying and everything. Just didn't show the fuck up.
Got scared.
Like, so, you know, like,
not gonna have to worry about that with me.
Well, that's like, good.
I'm not doing all this work to not show up.
Yeah. Well, that's the big stress about, you know, even running the events is just when people, I'm big on, I don't try and waste anyone's time. So it annoys the fuck out of me when someone wastes my time. And so, you know, like, that's more or less what we're trying to do is we're trying to get all these fake fighters who truly aren't even trying to benefit the sport or even fight out the fucking door. And we're trying to fuel more opportunities to those fighters who are legit in the gym training and trying to make this a lifestyle.
Right.
Well, but boys, I got to get going. Go.
We'll let you get out of here.
Good have you, Dwayne.
Thanks again for having me, you guys. Look forward to seeing you soon.
See you soon. Train hard.
Yes, sir.
All right, guys. Thank you joining us another week for the Intuit podcast, War of the Shore, Big Sexy, bringing it to you. We had Dwayne in the house and a pretty phenomenal athlete. I'm excited to have him and all that comes with that trilogy fight. It had to be the main event just because all around it, and you guys will see when you show up. January 14th, Elevate Fight League 1 at the Action Building in Canton, Georgia. Come check it out. We got a pretty big fight card. Matson's on it. Austin's on it. Looks like Chris is going to be on it now from up in Chattanooga. Billy's going to be in-house, signing boobies and kissing babies. Come check it out.
Hey, guys, thanks for tuning in. You know, A&F, we'll be having our fifth event. We're struggling kind of locking in a venue at the moment. But as soon as I get a venue locked in, which we've got a couple possibilities, we'll announce it and everything and get the marketing in and get the ball rolling on that. Be sure, like I said, if you're in town or whatever, go check out Warren's event. Like, people don't understand. There's a lot of these shows that they're not putting on good quality events, but I can promise you, like, there's some very good quality matchups on Warren's card. Even though it's an all amateur event, you're going to see some knockouts. You're going to see some submissions. You're just going to see some all out wars. Like, it's one hell of a time. And if you've never been to an MMA event or even just a martial arts event in general, in person, it's 10 times more, it's 10 times more, you know, enthusiastic and contagious when you're in person as to just watching it on.
Totally agree. And next week, guys, we'll have you maybe a holiday edition. We probably won't film Christmas week, so we'll probably do a holiday edition next week. I'll let you know the address. You can send us presents. Billy may do it shirtless with a bow on his chest. You know, we'll see what we got for you.
You know, I'll do it with me shirtless and Ember tied in a ribbon on my titties.
Wear the Christmas sweater. Where's that thing at?
But, guys, definitely thanks for tuning in. We appreciate everything, and we'll get you guys another episode next week.
Thank y'all. See ya. Yeah.